everyone, and welcome. Thank you for joining us for today's Meet the Analyst webinar, Tech Trends to Watch, the Metaverse Space, AI, and More. I'm your host, Jessica Liss, analyst at Insider Intelligence in New York. And I'm joined by my colleague, principal analyst, Yory Wurmser, who's in New Jersey. Hi, Yory. It's great to have you here.
Great to be here, Jess.
Before we get into the main presentation, I'd like to thank Snowflake for making today's webinar possible. We'll be hearing later on from Ganesh Subramanian, Director of Product Marketing at Snowflake. Ganesh is joining us from the Bay Area. Hi, Ganesh.
Hey, Jessica. Thanks for having us.
A few things before we dive in. We have a ton of information to share, but there's no need to take notes. We'll be emailing you a link to view the slides and the full recording after this. But we do want you to participate. So just use the window on the lower right-hand side of your screen to submit any questions at any time during the presentation. We'll get to as many as we can during the Q&A. So with that, Yory, let's get started. What's on the agenda today?
Thanks, Jess, and thanks to everyone for joining us in today's webinar on tech trends in 2022. So before looking at what's going to happen this year, I just want to take a second to look what we've just gone through, which is the pandemic, and what got us through these crazy past 2 years. And it was really some big bets in technology, the mRNA vaccines, which were a scientific bet, the rapid delivery, and even video conferencing. Some of those bets seemed a bit far-fetched when they first were thought of, but they all became crucial in the past couple of years. And in 2022, we're going to see some big bets play out that have been percolating for the last few years, but I think we're going to see the beginning of the payout of what's going to happen. So space-based connectivity is one to narrow the broadband gap. The metaverse, we're not going to see the metaverse take off, but we are going to see a lot of investments start to happen in some of the devices that will lay the groundwork for the metaverse, whatever that's going to be developed this year. We'll see voice-based internet, so things like speakers, but much beyond that developed this year. But we're also going to look at how some of the technology, some lingering issues that the technology industry has avoided or not dealt with fully will still play a role, and that's privacy and algorithmic bias. I also just want to add, this isn't comprehensive to all the huge trends happening in technology. There are, of course, huge developments in sustainable tech, batteries, Web3, lots of things we could talk about. We only have 25 minutes, so we're going to focus on this. So the agenda for today is really focusing on these five trends. The first is dreaming of owning the metaverse is going to drive big tech investments. And what this means is we're not going to predict what's going to happen with the metaverse in 10 years. That's unknowable. But I want to look at some of the things that are happening this year that will make a difference down the line and that will make a difference even if the metaverse doesn't come to be as envisioned. Second, I want to look at privacy regulations and specifically how they're shaping business strategies worldwide as they're getting as both enforcement is getting tighter and the rules are expanding to different areas. I also want to look at the space race to bridge the digital divide. What that means is broadband connectivity is a big issue around the world. There are a whole series of satellite networks that are going to be come online this year that's going to help bridge that gap. I'll look into that. Fourth, we'll look at ethical AI and how it's become a core practice. Ethical AI is not a new concept. There's been a lot of controversy in the last couple of years over algorithms that have had bias in it. Industry is starting to pay attention to it, but they really need to make it a core practice this year, and I'll look at a little bit at that. And the last trend that I want to look at is around voice-enabled technology. Developing a lot this year with more advanced virtual assistants and also car-based systems as well. So those are the five trends we'll look into. Let's start with the first one, dreams of owning the metaverse. And how that's going to drive big tech investments. So the idea of the metaverse is not a new one. The word originated in 1992 in Neal Stephenson's novel, Snow Crash. And there's not one vision of the metaverse. There's several competing visions. There's several visions of blending the physical with the virtual world that aren't being called the metaverse. But there's a consistent theme of just aligning that difference between the physical world and our life online. And a lot of stuff is going to happen this year around that. It's not the first time we've talked about this. Second Life in 2003 was an early version of this. You have some of that going on in Roblox, some of the games out there, a lot of stuff going on, and it has been going on. It just with Facebook announcing a big dive into the metaverse, changing its name to Meta, it's gotten a lot more play this year. But beyond that, there's a lot of innovation that's happening behind the scenes. Facebook is obviously the big proponent of it. Has made a lot of effort by buying Oculus several years ago, developing VR tools, developing AR tools, augmented reality tools, but they're definitely not alone. Pretty much every big tech company is investing in AR or VR hardware. You have Apple with its rumored AR and VR glasses and headsets. You have Google buying North a few years ago, a smart glasses company. Microsoft has HoloLens, Snap has spectacles. You can go on and on. Pretty much every company is doing something along these lines. But it's not just the hardware that's being developed, it's also software. You have all of these companies developing developer platforms for augmented reality and virtual reality, but you also have gaming companies doing the same thing. You have Epic, you have Roblox, you have Unity, you have NVIDIA, Niantic. You have all these companies that are developing platforms for augmented reality or virtual reality. A ton of innovation going to happen, and you're going to see a lot of kind of the early fruit of that this year. And actually, one more thing in the last, I'll hop back for a second. The chart just shows the incredible explosion that we're going to see in augmented reality headsets and virtual reality headsets, from 3 million shipments this year to 21 million augmented reality headset shipments in 2025, and a similar trend in virtual reality. Big increase in these dedicated headsets. But that's not the only type of device that's going to benefit from the metaverse. So augmented reality headsets are cool, but smart glasses are essentially going to deliver similar type of experiences when they come out. And you're going to see other wearables as well play into the metaverse. You're going to have vests. You already saw it at CES. OWO, a Spanish startup, had a vest that provides haptic feedback, sort of sensations in response to how a game is being played. Facebook had a demo of a glove that would create movements in the metaverse, in virtual reality, but also provide some haptic feedback. You're seeing a lot more, you'll see a lot more of this merging of sensations using wearables this year as well. And we expect wearables to really take off. This chart is really on existing form factors. It's our forecast for what we think smartwatches, hearables, and fitness bands are going to do this year. It doesn't show a tremendous growth, because a lot of the growth is going to happen in other areas. Gloves, wearable clothes will let you interact with the metaverse, and smart glasses. I think smart glasses are going to be pretty crucial as well. Although VR gets the attention, we expect augmented reality to actually have a bigger splash in the near term. And the reason is smart glasses and mobile AR as well. We expect that the threshold for a lot of people buying and using virtual reality headsets is a lot higher than using mobile AR or using other versions of AR. So in the near term, we expect an AR vision to be less intimidating and have a lot more promise. Secondly, we expect the race, a race to map the physical world and tag it with location data. And you're already seeing companies like Snapchat and Niantic and Google really develop a 3D version of the world that can be used for all types of anchored experiences in that world that can link up to a virtual world. And at the same time, that mapping can be pretty useful for autonomous traffic as well. Things like vehicles, they're separate maps, but the same type of idea plays out in both. And lastly, we think Apple is going to be kind of an unsung player in the metaverse. It has not been at the forefront of announcing big moves into the metaverse. It is actually officially said that they're not all that interested in creating their own metaverse, but they are developing a lot of devices that will have a big impact on how the metaverse develops, whether it's smartwatch, whether it is augmented reality glasses or a headset, virtual reality headset. We are pretty sure they're going to play a big role pushing that forward. And at the same time, they're also pushing forward companies to develop their own platforms, just by the fact that the rules around privacy has compelled a lot of companies and other rules that they have on their platform have compelled companies to think about alternative platforms to use and to develop. So Apple's going to play a big role, even if they don't forefront the metaverse and what they do. Secondly, the second trend we want to talk about is around privacy regulations that will shape business strategies worldwide. So what we've seen over the past couple of years are increasing regulations around the world. Obviously, there was GDPR in Europe, which set the standard. CCPA, which is the California Consumer Protection Act, came online recently. But you're seeing a whole proliferation of these privacy laws across the world. China and Brazil, at the end of the second half of 2021, came out with pretty strict privacy rules, pretty strict privacy laws. They joined 15 other countries that already had laws. You saw additional laws in the US and US states. California, Virginia, and Colorado all have additional laws. And California has the CPRA, Consumer Privacy Rights Act, I believe, that will start in January 1st, 2023. Virginia's as well in January, and Colorado's in July 2023. So tons of regulations trying to put a weight on top of what businesses have to pay attention to. And beyond that, there's pressure, consumer pressure, for even additional regulations. This chart from Data for Progress shows that 72% of US likely voters feel that privacy laws are still insufficient. So you will still see more pressure for privacy laws in this country, as well as federal privacy law. There's definitely an attention to this by business. It's not that business is not aware of it. They've obviously had to comply to all these laws. In this Optimizely survey that was published in November, I'm not sure when it was run, but 47% of business executives globally put privacy regulations and guidelines as a primary focus of their digital teams in 2022. So it's going to be a big focus for a lot of different companies. What we expect this year is that a comprehensive federal privacy law is probably going to still remain elusive. I predicted there would be one last year. I ate crow because it didn't come close. I'm not going to go out on a limb again this year, but I do think we're going to see a lot more intervention by the Federal Trade Commission that'll tighten some privacy rules that are out there using existing laws. You'll probably see movement towards a privacy law. There's bipartisan support for it. There's still some differences. And eventually there will be a federal privacy law. I'm just not sure if it's going to be this year or next year, but it's coming for sure. Number two is that the international laws will make data localization and compliance more important. So a lot of these privacy laws require data to stay within countries. Certainly true of Chinese law. At the moment, Europe is kind of similar because a safe harbor rule was knocked down by the European Court of Justice. So data localization is an issue. I think between Europe and the US, they'll come to an agreement where data sharing between them is going to be possible. But it is something where you're seeing more focus on localization, but also compliance, so that if you do share it, you're following very strict local laws to do so. And lastly, we think there's going to be a lot of innovation around privacy tech. We've already seen a lot of it. Sure, Ganesh is can talk more about this than I do, but a lot of work around clean rooms, differential privacy, data warehouses, aggregated data, cohorts, you name it. There are all types of ways of using privacy safely, respecting laws, and we're going to see innovation around that this year as well. third thing I want to talk about is the space race to bridge the digital divide. And it's less about the space technology than about the issue that it's addressing. And that's that it's still a huge amount of the world, and even in this country, don't have access to high-speed internet. This chart by the Economist Intelligence Unit from this year shows that only about a third of the people with a smartphone have fixed broadband connections. And that's only about a billion people. Sounds like a lot, but among 7 billion, it's really not. And in fact, only about half people are connecting to the internet altogether. There's this huge gap, leaving a major part of the global population out of the internet, or if they're connecting with very slow internet. You're definitely seeing that in the US as well. Broadband Now estimates that 42 million people in the US can't buy broadband service, any fixed broadband service. It's a huge number. And if you look at the disparate, if you break it down by race, age, education level, income, region, you're seeing a lot of disparity, racial disparity, especially among Hispanic population. 25% of Hispanic citizens who have a smartphone don't have home broadband. That's a huge number, 1 in 4. You're seeing rural and urban, dense urban populations also be underserved. And this number doesn't even consider the number of people who do have home broadband, but not fast home broadband, which means they can't really do a lot of the stuff, a lot of the media, a lot of work that you can do once you are connected with a rapid internet connection. The US infrastructure bill that was passed in the fall, it tries to address this. There's $65 billion in there that was committed to reducing broadband inequality in the US. Not all of that is going to subsidize additional broadband service, but a lot of it will. About two-thirds of it is going to subsidizing in some form or another broadband service, fixed broadband service, or 5G development with high-speed internet in the US. There's a lot of money out there, a lot of vendors who will vie for that. And I think the timing is really good for a lot of these satellite networks that have been launching at the low Earth orbits. They've been launching thousands of satellites, or hundreds in some of these cases. There's Starlink, there's OneWeb, there's Amazon Project Kuiper. There are more than this. These aren't the only networks. These are all trying to serve these hard to reach areas, rural areas, areas around the world that don't have fixed broadband. They're very expensive networks to launch and to create. Starlink's already operational, has a handful of customers, a few, I believe it's 140,000 now. This is a huge opportunity. The spending that's going on in the US and globally to try to expand broadband connectivity is a big opportunity for these companies. And we expect a lot of investment to go into it and a lot of development this year among those networks. So our predictions are, first of all, we expect that investment and partnerships are just going to increase this year in satellite connectivity. A lot of investments have been, I believe there were 321 investment rounds or since 2012 in these companies, not obviously any one company, but the industry. It's just going to accelerate or build this year. We'll see the first services mature. Starlink will expand, Project Kuiper launch. We'll see a lot more activity in this area. A second prediction we have is that it won't go smoothly. Things in space always take longer than you expect. I'm a huge astronomy buff. The Webb telescope launched 15 years late. It took $10 billion to launch up there. It is an engineering marvel and has gone flawlessly, but it's been on the back of all these failures that have happened in the engineering process, which have been solved. It's a tremendous achievement of engineering, but there were delays and cost overruns. It wouldn't be surprising that we see some delays in 2022 as well. But the likely effect of this, of these networks, is that costs will go down all over, not just on these via these services, but by providing competition to the existing broadband services. We expect a lot more people to be connected. and a lot more people to have access to decent internet at a good price. And the final prediction is that the drive to expand broadband access is going to create a whole new group of consumers and group of workers that have access to digital services, whether it's digital commerce, whether it's digital media, or whether it's opportunity to work remotely. It's a big deal for these people, and it's a big opportunity for businesses and companies as well. The fourth trend that I want to talk about is ethical AI, and specifically the focus on business and how businesses need to take a bigger, a more comprehensive strategic approach to it. So there's no question that AI has huge potential for business and society. People have gained a lot already from these automated systems, from better, you know, from systems to that can anticipate problems, to, you know, all types of these automated systems that demand artificial intelligence, whether it's natural language processing, whether it's computer vision, whether it's any other form of artificial intelligence. But there are genuine concerns that people have. This data from YouGov, it's an August 2021 survey, felt that the 42% were worried about the potential for augmented, for artificial intelligence in the wrong hands. And from our perspective, I think the 28% who are concerned about the negative effects on society that we can't predict today are really expressing a sentiment that, you know, these algorithms are having a lot of power over us by choosing what we see, what we can buy, what credit we have. So it's really important to iron out any biases that are in there. And we already saw a lot of controversies over the past couple of years, whether it was Twitter having images cropped for people of color, people of color being cropped out of images because the AI bias didn't recognize them, to Amazon having a hiring AI that discriminate against women, to Google having Timnit Gebru, their lead on trying to address biases within their natural language, their language AI, quitting because the company wasn't doing enough. All of these issues have just raised the profile of algorithmic bias, and rightly so. But to be fair, people and professionals within the industry realize it's a big issue. And in fact, 27% of professionals, data professionals, in an Anaconda April 2020 survey cited the social impacts from bias in data and models as the biggest problem in AI and machine learning. And I would bet that number may even be higher now. I think companies are really thinking about it. And you can see it in this chart as well, where 59% of respondents of companies, of executives worldwide that are thinking about approaches to detecting how their AI models may have bias, 59% evaluate the fairness of the outcomes from their AI tools. So that's good. Still 41% are, which is not good, but 59%, that's a decent number. But when you look at what they're actually doing, they're not doing it in a totally objective way. Only 11% are relying on a third-party model of evaluation or certification. It may not be necessary to have a third party come in, but at the very least, you probably want to have an AI ethics board, which only 22% of companies have, or some other auditing of the AI system internally that will really look to see if there's significant AI bias. So our predictions are that, like with privacy, we're going to see more action in this area. We're seeing there's a bill in Congress that addresses bias, requires transparency and, you know, the choices that these algorithms are making. Hasn't progressed beyond committee yet, but it's there. We're seeing more and more activity there. We're seeing the FTC create rules around algorithmic bias. Again, though, they're limited because they're using the Fair Credit Ratings Act, which is an old act meant to make sure that people have access to credit. So they can only really regulate egregious errors that are obviously discriminating against people, not necessarily laying down how companies act. Definitely expect more around that. We're expecting More activity in Europe, which has the EU Artificial Intelligence Act in front of the commission now. That's a much more comprehensive program than in the US that will require much more transparency. And as with the case with GDRP, what Europe does will probably set the tone for what happens elsewhere. You've already seen New York State create a law that that lays out exactly how AI algorithms can look at employment. More state laws are likely to come. It's an issue that's just going to increase in importance and in salience. And the prediction three is there's going to be more revelation of algorithmic bias that's going to damage brands. It's not just a question of having egg on your face as a brand. This is there's real brand damage that comes when you seem you've built in biases in your algorithm. So the companies that take proactive steps create a really strong system of regulating their algorithms and avoiding these problems and being transparent about how they choose things are really going to have an advantage. The last thing I want to talk about is kind of the fruit of one of these AI models, or not one of them, but a whole group of them, and that's speaking with machines or voice technology. Voice technology has come immensely far in the past couple of years, in part because of a lot of these open source natural language processing programs that are out there, and more proprietary ones as well. The biggest, their most obvious use cases are virtual assistants, Alexa, Google Assistant, Siri. Certainly within voice assistants and Alexa, you're seeing a lot more, or smart speakers, you're seeing a lot more diversity in the way people are interacting with their voice-enabled systems. This is one of our surveys that we did with BizRate, just came out. We conducted this in December. 34% of people use their speakers, their smart speakers, to control other appliances or other items within the smart house. Makes a lot of sense. There are smart lights, refrigerators, temperatures, whatever. 34% of people are using their speakers for that. But you're also seeing an increase of uses for commerce. You're seeing 31% asking for product recommendations, 19% of ordering digital content, 19% ordering products that they've bought before, so replenishment orders, and 14% that are purchasing products straight from their speaker. That's a lot of activity that in past years we didn't see through speakers. But speakers are just one part of the voice ecosystem. In fact, a bigger gateway to voice-enabled internet is our smartphones. There are 112.4 million US adults who are connecting to their voice assistant by a smartphone, or will this year. These are our numbers, and that compares to 96.2 million who connect via smart speakers. So definitely when we talk about voice-enabled commerce or voice-enabled internet, it starts with the phone at this point. But it may not start there for long, because connected cars are becoming a bigger and bigger opportunity. Even today, we have 146.9 million connected car drivers in the US. Not all of those are connecting to voice assistants. A lot of them are. But we expect that as these systems become a lot more sophisticated, a lot more internet connectivity is going to happen through the car. And you're already starting to see a lot of innovation around voice activity in products that are coming out this year. The CES, the Consumer Electronics Show, that closed in Las Vegas at the end of last week, just was filled with announcements around voice-enabled systems, whether it was new alliances or the development of standards for interoperability like Matter, which is between a lot of the big tech companies that lets your Alexa smart speaker interact with a Google Home device or light, allowing the whole smart home to work together. And you're also seeing the Home Connectivity Alliance was announced at CES, and that's an alliance of appliance makers. So you're going to see the same type of convergence among the home appliances as you are among the smart kind of the IoT devices within the home. That's just going to make voice a lot more present as a gateway into the internet in the home. You're obviously seeing a ton of home devices, whether it's the smart speakers, alarm clocks, faucets, you name it. Pretty much any type of speaker device out there now has some support. There's some version of it out there that has voice enabled functions. Wearables are including more voice assistants or these on the lower left corner, that image is of Garmin watches that have some connectivity to voice. Smart glasses are going to have connection to voice. Just a lot of innovation there. And lastly, they're in-car systems. Volvo, this image on the left here and that square is Volvo now builds Google Assistant or Android Auto straight into the car system. So much more seamless integration there. You're seeing more wireless integration. And you're also seeing, because of that better integration, you're seeing new types of devices in the car. For instance, a 31-inch screen in the back seat of a car, which as a parent of three daughters is incredibly compelling to me. So that's really the type of thing that we're going to see more of going forward. Predictions around that, this around this final trend is search optimization for voice will grow in importance as more people use search, more likely they are to, as more people use voice-enabled assistants, the more important search and being that top of the search queue becomes. So that's going to gain greater relevance this year. Digital audio advertising is going to grow more quickly. We've already seen really rapid growth in things like podcast advertising, which is going to grow at more than 30% this year. Services like Spotify are growing at more than 20%. Lots going on there. And as I said earlier, we expect a lot more innovation around cars and car apps. So just to recap, it's still too early to know whether the metaverse is hype or how it's actually going to come about, if it does, you know, the shape it takes when it comes about. But it's real enough that it's driving business investments today and all types of immersive technologies. Privacy regulations enforcement are going to tighten globally, so businesses are just going to have to up their data game. Third, expanding broadband access is going to be a big focus in 2022, and that's going to be enabled and also help space-based internet play a bigger role. Fourth, AI is crucial for the growth of society, but also companies will need to institute better policies to identify and fix algorithmic bias. And lastly, voice is going to become an even more important gateway to the internet as connected cars and smart home devices proliferate. With that, I'll hand it back to Jess.
That was great. Thank you, Yory. So before we get to any audience questions live, we're now joined by Ganesh Subramanian, who is the Director of Product Marketing at Snowflake. Welcome again, Ganesh. Thanks again for being here.
Yeah, thanks, Jessica. And just Yory, that was amazing. I can't believe that comprehensive amount of research was, you were able to present that in that short amount of time, but thank you for walking through all of that.
Yeah, my pleasure.
So we'll dive into a few questions for you, Ganesh. So we've covered a number of big trends here. Could you share your perspective on the role of data and how companies will need to evolve their data strategies to take advantage of these opportunities?
Yeah, absolutely. And when I look back at some of the big themes that Yory was bringing up there, everything from AI to using data in a very privacy-centric manner, things from the AR, VR evolution and the metaverse, it, underlying all of that is data. And when you think about what has enabled companies to be successful with data over the past few years, it's a phenomenal case study. You know, the pandemic just pretty much uprooted business as usual, life as usual. And what we saw was that organizations with a pretty firm data strategy, and we can define that in a little bit more detail, but organizations were with control of their data, ability to deploy that data and make it accessible in a very secure and governed way, they adapted so quickly and they adapted to a new normal and tech and kind of leveraged their existing competitive advantage to differentiate what they do in this crazy world we're in. You know, you look at the flip side, organizations without that data foundation Many of them struggled and it didn't quite materialize the way in a very positive way for them over the past few years. So going forward, thinking about these trends, you know, organizations with that data foundation are really set up for success. And those that who don't should really think about how do they invest in one so that they can take advantage of some of these trends going forward. And that's where Snowflake comes into play. For folks who don't know us, we are essentially the data cloud. What we do is we break down data silos first and foremost within an organization's virtual four walls. Typically, data sits fractured across all of these different point systems, and it's very hard for organizations to bring all that together to really drive their strategy on any initiative. What Snowflake does is we provide a single repository for all that data, and we make it accessible across organizations. But the other thing organizations are doing with the data cloud is now collaborating across their industries. So that's really the next evolution and maybe a big trend that I see as a data trend that's going to enable success going forward in almost every vertical. So what does this collaboration kind of look like? Just to give our audience kind of a very tangible sense, what this chart shows is actually individual businesses on the data cloud back in April 2020, and then flash forward to October of last year. Kind of funny to say that now we're in 2022. Each dot represents an account on the Snowflake Data Cloud network, and each line represents a collaboration point, someone sharing data with another organization. And so back in April, this was a very nascent concept, but this is starting to hit that inflection curve where now it's becoming a competitive differentiator to be able to share that data with organizations in a very secure and compliant way without having to rely on all the legacy baggage, things like data copies and movement and transformation. This is now a world where access to data doesn't have to be limited by technology. And so, you know, back to your question around what do we see organizations doing going forward with data, on this final slide here, you can get a kind of a more granular sense of what we're seeing. So, you know, the first kind of example here in the top here in blue text, think about any marketer today is working with a suite of marketing technology. And if you think about your marketing cloud or maybe one of your customer engagement suites, how do you get that customer 360 materialized in those platforms so you can actually drive the right type of personalized communication? We're seeing data sharing being a huge differentiator here, where that entire MarTech stack, once on the data cloud, is now enabling instant access to that common source of customer data so that the right message is going out to the right time. The second big thing is, what about third-party data? And two examples here, we've seen COVID-19 data be the number one utilized data source on our Snowflake Data Marketplace. So organizations are tapping into publicly available data sets or proprietary data sets, but again, in near real time without having to create individual relationships with all these data providers. And so what do they do with that data? It can inform everything from demand planning on a regional basis. It might inform discounts or what kind of inventory they need to stock, so on and so forth. Another example is financial data. That might dramatically change who you're targeting with what offer, or it might determine your future strategy. And then the bottom part here, tons of organizations are actually creating unique partnerships on the basis of data. And Yory talked earlier about how do you share data in a very secure and compliant way? And he referenced data clean rooms. This is something we're seeing enormous attention to, especially with things like the deprecation of third-party cookies and IDFAs going away. How do organizations share and collaborate to deliver a better customer experience and business outcomes without revealing PII? And that's where things like data clean rooms come into play, where you can now share very compliantly without revealing any PII, and we can really build your data strategy on the backbone of first-party data. So broad swaths, a couple of the big things we're seeing on the data side.
Thank you for that overview. That was really interesting, Ganesh. So you mentioned that some of these businesses are not set up with this data foundation yet. So what do you think that businesses need to do in order to set up this data foundation? And why do you think many organizations today might be struggling with this?
Yeah, it's a good question. And, you know, if it were easy, if it was just business as usual, it would likely already be done. But the truth is that business as usual is what leads to this fractured data foundation, right? People are doing the best they can with the existing technology they have, which leads to workarounds and point solutions. And perhaps the mother of all solutions is an analyst on a Friday night or Saturday morning working in Microsoft Excel, pairing data together. So how do you get out of this business as usual problem is you need to change state. You need to actually take a conscious process and work across the organization to make an effort to really build that foundation. And how does that happen? In my opinion, what the single most common ingredient for successful transformation is a partnership across the technical folks in an organization, usually in an IT organization, and the line of business leaders. And for the audience here, I think about the CIO and the CMO coming together, aligning on what outcomes they need to go drive, and then tapping into the right technology to make that happen. That's usually the start. That's not the end. Then you need to start thinking about the right technology for your organization, one that works for your initial use cases, but certainly one that will test the time of as markets change. And so, as we kind of talked about earlier, breaking down data silos within your virtual four walls, we think that's going to be competitive differentiation for only a little bit while longer. But tapping into the network effect of sharing data across industries, that's really going to be the future for organizations to succeed.
Great, thank you. Now, to get a little bit more specific, could you maybe share some examples of companies that are leveraging data in new ways?
Yeah, absolutely. And I know our audience might span the gamut, so maybe we'll quickly touch upon a few. I think one of the awesome examples that I've seen recently, for folks who don't know, Mod Pizza, fast casual restaurant based in the United States. Historically, you know, I've loved them because they're all about the customer experience. You come in and they have all these customizable options on their pizzas and salads. Imagine how the pandemic hit them, right? You know, just their entire brand proposition from in-person experience just went up and out the door. In a matter of 3 weeks, what we saw them do is remarkable. They transformed their store layout so people could order and then pick up, that you could actually package and deliver their products, and people could pick them up at all these different national retail outlets. Number two, they launched a digital experience. So from the in-person experience, now they had an application where you could click and collect effectively. And then number three, they changed their menu. They actually used to optimize on add-ons for the individual consumer. They went to family meals and packages. And they did this all because they had a strong data foundation, and they were able to do this all in 3 weeks. Now that's a consumer-facing kind of retail fast casual example. I'll touch upon a few others quickly. You know, we talked about data governance and security. In the media publisher space, we're seeing clean rooms take off like wildfire. Recently, Disney and NBCU announced their own advertising platforms powered by Snowflake, but really leveraging data clean rooms to create that direct end-to-end connection with their brand advertising clients. And now they're leveraging data in an extremely secure way, ensuring that privacy is at the forefront of their strategy, as Yory described. Now let's flip the script and talk about the advertiser side. One organization that I've seen make tremendous strides is PepsiCo, you know, huge umbrella organization with tons of brands. And what they saw was that in order to really get in front of this personalized experience, they no longer could rely on third parties alone to drive their media campaigns. So they actually brought all their data in-house, built the data foundation, and built on top of that an engine that they called the ROI engine. So they can measure in near real time the effectiveness of their ad campaigns across their portfolio. And so the last example I'd want to share is, you know, because of this trend of advertisers taking more control of their data, we're seeing the agency world and ad tech have to become more savvy and differentiate their value proposition even further in order to continue to win and retain their business. And a great example of that is WPP, which recently launched their data arm called Choreograph. And what they're doing is they've created an integrated data mesh across their entire agency suite, so that whenever one branch of the organization is leveraging a data investment, the rest of the organizations can tap into that investment and bring their entire weight to bear on behalf of their clients. And so data sharing, again, across organizations and within organizations in a very secure and compliant way is really powering all of this.
Thank you so much, Ganesh. So now it's time to get into our audience Q&A. We are receiving a lot of great questions. So to kick us off, not surprisingly, we've gotten several questions about the metaverse. So we'll start with a question from Andrea in Boston. What should brands do today about the metaverse?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a great question. I'm sure Ganesh will have some thoughts about this as well. If the metaverse comes about, it's going to come about in 10 years. We're really at the 1996 version of the internet right now. So it makes a lot of sense for brands to get a presence in augmented reality and virtual reality, to play around with it, just to get comfortable with what's happening there, to see how consumers react to it, see what works and what doesn't work. You're not going to make a ton of money in the metaverse this year. It doesn't exist really, but even the precursors of it, you're probably not going to gain a lot of new clients by having a 3D store as Samsung did at CES, or having billboards and games. But you're going to see what works and learn what works, and then incrementally build on that going forward. So really have a presence in AR and VR. Learn about it and start to play around with it. That's my advice.
That's awesome, Yory. Yeah, I think from a data perspective, going back to first principles, really this is an extension of that customer experience, another touch point with your customer. And it represents a new opportunity. We've seen clients in the gaming space, at the forefront of this, even before we get into AR and VR. What about just telemetry across these digital touch points and better understanding what's working, leading to better customer experiences, retention, better content to be produced? How do you upsell, cross-sell in this mechanism? And so when I think about what organizations should be thinking about, it's going back to first principles, first party data, getting a 360 degree view, and then working on that telemetry data, which will be a step in the right direction to prepare you for things like the metaverse.
Thank you both. So our next question comes from Marie at the University of Tennessee. So she's on the advertising faculty and is going to have more than 40 senior ad majors this semester. So she's wondering, what are the main things about the metaverse you'd want a new hire to know?
Well, I mean, I'd say there is not a metaverse. I think that's kind of the first thing I would say. The metaverse is still hype, but it's a development. It's kind of more of an ongoing development of what we've had to this point. First thing I'd want someone to know about the metaverse is that it's not going to look, and it's eventually not going to look about like these kind of frightening visions that Facebook put out when they renamed themselves. It's going to be more things like augmented reality experiences in the real world. Even if it is in virtual world, it's probably not going to be something where people spend 24 hours a day. It's really something that's going to be more about enhancing the way we live now than it is about some alternate, way of living that it's somehow portrayed. It's more of an extension of, it's more of an enhancement of our current life than a change of how we're going to live.
Great, thank you. All right, Ganesh, did you want to add something?
No, I really don't. I can't proclaim to be a prognosticator of the metaverse, but I think what Yory said, look, like things, sometimes we can get out in front of ourselves. Things tend to be a little more closer to where we are today than some of our far-fetched fantasies at times.
Great. So our next, we have a few questions on privacy, some about crypto. So we can start with privacy, given the data focus here. So from Juan in New York, with privacy becoming so important, what's the right balance in collecting first party data?
Ganesh, I might let you take that one. You're probably the expert here.
Sure. Yeah, I think that's the right balance in collecting first party data. So I think that the question is referring to, you know, how do you ensure that you are abiding by first principles when it comes to your customers? And, you know, that we've talked for years, I think, eMarketer for sure, and how important the customer experience is to customer acquisition and retention, lifetime value. And privacy is one of those things that is table stakes now. Like you can't just think of it as an afterthought. It needs to be core and essential to your strategy. And so, you know, why is privacy at the forefront? And what do you do with first party data? The delta or the important thing there is that data that you collect about your customers, especially data that they have consented for you to have and to use, is the most important part of your data strategy going forward. A lot of organizations leave value on the table because they don't connect all of their first party data together and use it in an appropriate way. What we've had to do previously was kind of circumvent the hard work and just rely on third party data. Now we're being forced to do the hard work and the good work, which is to actually use that data that you're getting directly from your clients to improve that customer experience. So in terms of the balance, the right balance, I go back to, you know, think about that first party data first and foremost. If you build that data foundation, you're in an excellent position to layer on additional data sets, either from third party or through industry partnerships.
Yeah, and I think that's spot on. And the only thing I'd add is just that companies should really think about, you know, why they're collecting the data and what they can use it for. And then to justify collecting it to their customers, you want to be able to explain that you're using the data in a way that actually makes their experience better.
Great, thank you both. So we're seeing how data and privacy are underlying all of these trends we've talked about today, but there's also been a lot of talk about crypto in 2021 and 2022. So how do you guys think this plays into these trends?
I mean, crypto is its own huge trend. Web3 problems, there are three big challenges when it comes to crypto that I see in 2022, and I think they'll overcome a lot of it. One is fungibility. I mean, Bitcoin, you can go out, trade in it, turn it into dollars. A lot of the cryptocurrencies out there you can use on certain platforms. You can't really exchange them easily. I think that's one area. Second is volatility. They're still really volatile, which makes planning around crypto kind of tough. And I think government is going to jump in at some point to try to regulate. So that's going to even increase volatility in the short term. And lastly, there's sustainability. A lot of these, you know, to generate a lot of these currencies, you have to use huge amounts of energy for mining. And you're starting to see solutions to that. And I think you're going to see a lot of innovation around that this year. Having said all that, you're going to see crypto pop up in a lot more situations. You're going to see blockchain technology also become much more pervasive, I think. Around, you know, throughout different applications than you see now, including possibly around data. I mean, I could see that, you know, if you just start decentralizing data collection and having people, giving people ownership of the data they produce, that could really have some interesting effects down the line as well. That's not a 2022 issue, you know, that we're talking, that would be something that happens down the line further. But yeah, lots of things around crypto this year.
Great, thank you, Yory. And with that timing, we have time for one more question. And this question comes from Tyler in San Diego, and it's kind of bringing us back to the foundation of all of this. So we've discussed new markets developing from better broadband access. Can you give any examples of these?
I mean, there are two that I see right away. One is just a lot more services geared towards rural or lower income people that is, you know, yeah. That people that are newly connected, providing services for them in a way that hasn't been done before. I think you can also see, just in terms of the job market, people, you have this new access group of people who are now connected who can work remotely in various ways. And I think that can be, that could transform not just digital world, but also how people are physically located around the country and around the world. You can work, you know, and you saw it already with the pandemic, you know, people working remotely. But if you spread the amount of people who have high-speed broadband, that just expands the job opportunities out there as well.
Great, thank you. So unfortunately, that is all we have time for today. Thank you for the great questions. And thanks again, Yory, for joining us. And a very special thank you to Ganesh and the team at Snowflake as well for making this possible. Also, our eMarketer production crew behind the scenes also deserves a huge thank you for making this webinar possible. They have been absolute rock stars while we've been planning this. So as promised, we'll be emailing you soon with a link to the slides and the full recording. And before we wrap up, I'm also going to take a moment just to tell you about what's happening across eMarketer's media channels. So you can register for any upcoming live analyst and tech talk webinars at eMarketer.com/webinars. And then on the audio side, don't forget to tune in to the Behind the Numbers podcast. So eMarketer's daily podcast at eMarketer.com/podcast. And finally, please check out all our newsletters. So yeah, thank you again for joining us, and please enjoy the rest of your work days.